Good evening to all. It's my great honor and privilege to have Dr. Francisco Sidrell, who is a scientist, who has come on this today's show and who is going to enlighten us about various ways in which this scientific research is going all over the world. So, good evening to Dr. Francisco Sidrell. And let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Vivek Sharma. I am working as Dean Academics and Research in Government Institute of Medical Sciences, Greater Noida, and I am also a professor of physiology. And I am also working in the field of alternative medicine integration with the natural, with the regular medicine, that is the modern medicine. And my interest lies a lot in looking into those people who can integrate various technologies. And so we cannot have a better person than Dr. Sidrell, who is working in this field. So let me introduce, let me give a bit of the idea about him and what he is doing. Dr. Francisco Sidrell has done ND, naturopathic doctor, with a master's and a PhD in neuroscience and a postdoctorate in health sciences. He has specialized in integrative therapies. And in the field of photobiomodulation, he's a big name, and neurobiology of pain and inflammation he's working presently. He's also the CEO of Scientifica Consulting LLC, Orlando, FL, and he's a chief scientific officer of BrainTap Technologies, New Burns, North Carolina, USA. He's working on multiple projects, multiple scientific projects all across the world. And his main area of interest lies in integrating photobiomodulation and various other technologies with other non-invasive technologies, for example, meditation. So welcome again, Dr. Sidrell, to this program, to this show. And how are you feeling? How are you today?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here. I'm very happy. I'm always happy to see you. So. And this is a special opportunity. So I love it. Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
So we are going to have a little bit of idea about who Dr. Francisco Sidrell is, how he has delved into this field of heartfulness meditation, and why he feels that integrative medicine is so big in it. So how have you been introduced to heartfulness meditation? And how it has brought about, and when was it that it occurred?
So, well, I have to thank you for that, because you were the one that introduced me to it. I mean, I practiced yoga many, many years ago and did a little meditation, but nothing like a very structured, you know, sequential practice. And when I had the opportunity of going to India last November, and I loved it, loved the country, loved the different venues that we have been to, the university, you know, thank you again for inviting me. Felt like I told you that, but I have to say it over here, that I felt a very deep connection with the country and with the people. I'm originally from Brazil. My family's from Italy, but I've been living in the United States for about 10 years now. And Brazilians are very much similar to Indians in the sense that they are very, very nice people, very warm, very receptive. And I really felt at home there. And then, you know, apart from being in among friends, Dr. Vivek here, my friend, I call him my brother from India, introduced me to heartfulness meditation. And actually his mother-in-law presented me with the two books by Daju, The Heartfulness Way and Designing Destiny. And then introduced me to the heartfulness meditation technique, the cleaning method, and the bedtime prayer. And I've been practicing ever since I left India, which was last November. So I would say I've been meditating every day, nonstop. I haven't skipped one day. So it's been 200 days, more or less, 6 months and 18 days, 20 weeks and 4 days, more or less. that I have been meditating, and it has touched me in a very, very special way. So therefore I'm here.
So what are the changes that you felt in your professional and in your personal life, how it has helped you out, that practicing heartfulness meditation?
So one thing for sure, and the first thing that everybody noticed, it was not just me, it was like the people that worked together with me, my friends and family, they told me that I'm much, much calmer. So stress reduction is something that happened very, very, very fast, right away. I also felt that there was an increase in my attention span. I mean, I'm able to concentrate more on specific subjects for a prolonged period of time without getting mental fatigue. I think that's very important. I noticed that, you know, when you have to read every day during the whole day and do calculations and work on methodologies, work with students and all that, you have this burnout, you know, feeling, and that has reduced dramatically, even though my workload has only increased. I think self-awareness is something also that is very important, and the ability to focus on, you know, my feelings and the emotions and the things that are happening to me at the moment that they're happening. And sometimes you have like those automatic reactions where you go into autopilot mode and you don't even realize. And this has I think that has helped me tremendously. There's this book that I'm reading, it's called The Buddha's Brain by Rick Hansen. And he talks about the four different stages of awareness. He says the first stage would be unconscious incompetence. And I'll give you like an example. For instance, somebody comes to the house and then they forget to bring something from the supermarket that you want. And then you just go, why didn't you bring it? And you get angry, you get nervous, and you answer back. You're just an unconscious way of talking back to the person, and you're being incompetent because you're not being able to control your feelings or express, you know, correctly. The second stage is conscious incompetence. You still get mad and you still talk back at a person, but you realize, oh, why am I doing this? And then the third stage is conscious competence. You still get mad, but you're able to hold your feelings and you say, I shouldn't get mad. I mean, this is going to get worse. And then the last one would be unconscious competence. You don't even get worried. You don't even realize that, you know, maybe in the past you would get nervous about that. So I'm feeling that now. I'm more and more in the third stage where I notice I get nervous, but I don't react. So, and I hope that the unconscious competence is happening a lot too, and I'm not noticing. So I think it's a lot of very good changes for me and for the family.
That's great. Dr. Sidral, I would like to ask a very basic question from you, because you are from a scientific background. Lots of people, they talk about that science is one thing and spirituality is a totally different thing. How do you think that this science and spirituality, they come together? Do you think that they make sense together? Do you think that it is going to help us in humanity, and how you are planning to do it? If at all you agree with that.
Absolutely. Those two fields are connected. They're interconnected the whole time. I mean, it's an essential aspect of the human being. When you talk about health, and it's been for many years now, even recognized by the World Health Organization, we just do not only look at the physical aspect or the mental aspect. You know, we also have to look at the environment, but the spiritual context is very, very important. And there is a lot of research out there showing the effects of for instance, prayer, showing the effects of having a belief and how that really interferes with your overall well-being and the well-being of everybody. So it's for me, it's an essential part of who we are, and it has to be, you know, explored and has to be talked about. And I think meditation is one big part of it. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I've heard that you are writing a book on photobiomodulation in Harvard University. Can you just tell a little bit what exactly is photobiomodulation, and what is your take on that in the non-invasive way of treatment?
To me, this is a topic that is very close to my heart. It's something that I studied throughout my career, doing my master's, doing my PhD and the postdoctorate. That's what brought me into the field of integrative medicine more and more in the science. I was after I graduated and then I did my specialization, I started teaching at the university in photobiomodulation, and I was following the students going through the residency program and using photobiomodulation every day. But I wanted to understand, I saw the effects, but I wanted to understand more what it was doing. That's why I went into my master's and my PhD in neuroscience to study the effects of photobiomodulation. To me, this is one of the medicines of the future. Non-invasive, no collateral effects, and something so simple that you can be very sophisticated with the devices and use them in the lab, or you can have home units that you use at home every day, even to prevent diseases from happening, because it's improving your metabolism. It's not like a drug that you take it and then it's going to, you're adding something to the system that is not natural sometimes. And photobiomodulation is stimulating natural functions, improving metabolism, you know, improve metabolic functioning, improving production of ATP in the cell, increase blood flow. And then there's a lot of very interesting effects that has been shown through transcranial photobiomodulation, neuroprotective effect, a very big antioxidative effect. It increases inflammation, it stimulates neurogenesis, and also stimulates neuroplasticity, synaptogenesis. So this, I think this is something that, like meditation, you should do every day a little bit. And the book that you mentioned was a chapter in a book by Dr. Hambly from Harvard University. And the book was actually published last year, but we continued the line of research. And in fact, yes, was it yesterday or 2 days ago, there was another paper on photobiomodulation by our group in Brazil that just got published.
So have you conducted any research on meditation also? Because I also consider it as one of the non-invasive therapy. I can consider that it is it can work on all the levels. It is preventive, promotive, curative, perhaps rehabilitative, we don't know, but at least three levels. Have you done any research work in the field of meditation technique?
Yeah, so let me give you a little background. I work with different labs and research institutes here in the US and Brazil, and I'm still an associate professor at the UniSul University in the south of Brazil. Together with Dr. Daniel Martins, about 10 years ago, we founded the lab of experimental neuroscience, and Dr. Daniel is still the head of the lab. The lab has different lines of work. One is manual therapy and associated therapies, because Dr. Daniel is a physical therapist by trade. Second is photobiomodulation. That was because of me. I introduced that. And then I'm also an acupuncturist. And so we have students doing their master's and the PhD studying acupuncture and associated techniques. Electroacupuncture just had another paper published a couple months ago. And now, because of you, actually, you're responsible for this. We're developing another line of work. That's going to be mindfulness and associated techniques, which include audiovisual brain entrainment, you know, with BrainTap, and now heartfulness meditation. As for publications, we only published one paper about a year and a half ago, and it was entitled "Pain-related encephalic regions influenced by meditation." It was an integrated review, and in the review, we looked at the literature and we saw that there is actually a very big effect on modulation of pain because of stimulation in anterior cingulate cortex, insular regions, and the secondary sensory cortex. So we saw that meditation actually induces analgesia and is potentially very important adjuvant treatment for pain management. So that was the only paper that we published so far with meditation.
Mm-hmm. So how do you plan to work, since now you have already found that heartfulness meditation is definitely at your personal level, is giving beneficial effect to you and of course to your family. How do you want to look into the research aspect of heartfulness meditation? What are the big worldwide projects you can think of that heartfulness meditation can be taken all across the globe?
So the first thing that we want to do is, I mean, I'm already doing a literature review and looking at the papers out there, and like we did that one with AIM, but looking at a more broader, you know, context. That's one thing. The second one is the idea for a cross-sectional study looking at the effect of heartfulness meditation on quality of sleep, stress, mood, and brain health. And the idea is to get look at people that are meditators and people that are not meditating. And then we do like an evaluation through, you know, pain health questionnaires, patient health questionnaires, perceived stress scale, quality of sleep, and those studies. And it should be a very big study, because we can look at people that have been meditating for a year or 2 years or 3 years, and people that have just are just starting, and then see if there are any differences in between all these different parameters, which I believe there is going to be, you know, and it could be a multi-center study. So we do it in conjunction with you in India, we do it in Brazil, and we do it here in the United States to start. So that would be the first part of it, which then we could turn into a longitudinal study and follow these same people 6 months from now, 5 years from now, 1 year, 10 years, and continue like that. So you have a picture, a snapshot right now, and then we look maybe a year from now, and then maybe two or three, and then we keep following them. That would be a very nice cross-sectional first, and then a longitudinal study with this.
So do you think it is feasible in today's world? Can we do it out? Can we do it? How much time does it take? Because if something is good, let's execute it out. Let's see to it that let's put it out to the people that heartfulness meditation works. So how much do you think will be the time feasible to initiate and to start off all these types of activities, taking it across all the globe?
So I think that the idea of the cross-sectional study is much easier to conduct than an interventional study. Because an interventional, you have to have a baseline, and then you have people do specific things for a period of time, and then you reevaluate. They already have this in their common practice. I mean, they're doing this every day already. So they're already doing the intervention. That's why a snapshot on a cross-sectional study is the easiest way of doing it. And it can be very simply done through questionnaires, online questionnaires. You just send out, they fill up the forms. It's going to take them, you know, 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes. And then we just do the analysis. More time is going to take in the analysis than in the participating, I guess. I guess with the help of the Heartfulness Meditation Association, it's going to be very easy because we could do it with the members. And there are members everywhere, right? In large, very large numbers. So
can you just guide us that whether this can be of any use, that we heartfulness meditation and photobiomodulation, if practiced together, do you think it makes sense, or it is going to have any form of the cognitive enhancing or any other form of impact or effect, synergistic effect you feel it can have?
I think so. I mean, there is what is known as brainwave entrainment that is done with audio, or is done also with light. And then also, you know, there is a lot of interesting studies looking at transcranial photobiomodulation to make changes into the brain waves. So meditation does that as well. So we probably, there is a combination that we can use together and then even enhance the effects. I think absolutely those two things go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. Can you please elaborate a little bit about it for our audience? What do you think are the effects of meditation on the brain and as well as on the heart? What do you feel, how it actually physiologically it improves the personality and as well as the internal system of the person, of the practicant?
Yeah, so overall, this is something that is very well established in the literature, that, you know, showing, for instance, reduced blood pressure, reduced irritable bowel syndromes or flare-ups in people that have colitis, decreased symptoms of anxiety, depression, helping people with insomnia. Meditation has been proven to do all that. There is a lot of good quality studies now with meditation. Of particular interest, I would say the ones that use functional magnetic resonance imaging, functional MRI, and it really shows that meditation actually physically changes the brain. There was a study that was conducted by Dr. Lazarus at Harvard University a couple of years ago, looking at long-term meditators and people that are not meditating. And then they actually saw a physical increase in the amount of gray matter in the insula, which has to do with the pain perception, social engagement, and empathy, emotions, and numerous other vital functions. And also sensory regions like the auditory cortex and the sensory cortex, which makes sense. I mean, you're meditating, you're paying attention to your breathing sounds, you're paying attention to, you know, to your heart, you're paying attention to the present moment. So those senses are heightened. They also found that there is more gray matter in the frontal cortex, and it's associated with, of course, everybody knows working memory and executive decision-making. So makes us better thinkers and makes us more emotionally tuned to the environment. this is very well documented. And what was interesting is that this region of the brain has to do also with aging. It has to do people that like from starting 50 and over, you know, those meditators, they have the same amount of gray matter as people that have there are like 25 year olds. So it means it has an anti-aging effect on your brain. And another study that was very interesting too shows that these changes can start to be seen only after 8 weeks. So they got people that are not meditating and then they started meditating. And after only 8 weeks, they started to see changes. And that's very fast, very fast.
Mm-hmm. How do you think, especially in this COVID-19 epidemic, pandemic through which our whole world is going through, how do you think that these non-invasive technologies, especially I would like to focus on two of the things. I have already talked about photobiomodulation. Heartfulness Institute also especially for the children group, there is a lot of work going on the neural entrainment. That means through this biofeedback entrainment. So how do you think that COVID-19 epidemic, what is the importance of practicing heartfulness meditation or going for biofeedback entrainment by alpha, beta, theta, and various other wave patterns? And I'm sure that I know that you are having an expertise in that. Can you please elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I'm working on this area with different companies and different products. One of course is the one that you know of, the audiovisual brain entrainment through BrainTap technologies. And then this moment, I think it's kind of unique in our lifetime, but it can repeat itself, I think, you know. And maybe this is going to happen again next year. Maybe this is going to happen again in a couple of years. And people have realized the importance of taking care of themselves, because at the end of the day, who gets the more serious problems with COVID and who doesn't? A lot of people are going to be exposed if they have not yet. I mean, how long is this vaccine going to take? There's a lot of people are still going to get infected. And how do you protect yourselves? You know, you have to improve your immune system. You have to be more relaxed. You have to reduce stress. And those things are things that are going to affect the outcome when you get the virus. Not only that, if you already had it and you had the symptoms and you had to be hospitalized, look at the state of your health right now. You know, you have to do those things. And photobiomodulation, audiovisual brain entrainment, heartfulness meditation, those are things that help your body inside out. It helps you cope with not only COVID, but everything else that is going to come our way. And people are starting to realize that there is like a tremendous increase in stress-related problems. I just saw some news from Brazil. There was like a 45% increase in heart attacks in Brazil, in strokes and everything else. And we know that there is a big component of stress there. So stress management tools and heartfulness meditation, I know it's a lot more than that, but it's a very, very nice tool to help people deal with the stressful, you know, situation that they're in right now and prevent if they get infected and also recover faster, you know, after they get it.
That's interesting, because I also feel that COVID-19 is spreading in two ways. One is infectious, another is non-infectious stress route. And non-infectious stress route is affecting all 7.8 billion inhabitants of this earth.
Yes.
And
yes.
I do believe that we need lots and lots of economically viable solutions. So regarding heartfulness meditation techniques which you have used, how do you think that you can be one of the tools of taking it to Brazil? Specifically, since you are from that area, you have come from there, now from Italy, and now presently in US. How do you think that you can be a tool as a scientist or as a practitioner? In what ways you think that if it is good tool, you can spread it out to the other areas? You can increase the awareness of the other areas.
So one of the ways is through research. You know, so involving universities in Brazil, and then we're talking about large numbers. The university that I work with has about 25,000 students in one location. but it's a part of a network that has about 150,000 students. So if we start a program and then we start the research through the health sciences department and in the lab of experimental neuroscience, the idea is to start involving the 25,000 that are in that location and then expand from there. Another way is through talks and conversations and seminars and summits. I mean, wherever we're participating, I start talking about it. The third way is I have a very good association with the Salgado Institute of Integrative Health in Brazil, which is a physical therapy institute and school, but they focus on integrative physical therapy, and they have about more or less 40,000 students have been through the programs so far. Wow. So we have that reach. We're creating talks and seminars and to spread these are physical therapists and medical professionals in the country, which then of course are going to talk to their customers about it. And then I think it's a very nice thing. And I feel that this is not something anymore just for me, it's not just something that I'm interested in. I feel this is part of my mission. It's something that I have to do to help people.
Wow, that's great. Both the things are so exciting. The numbers which you have told, talking it to academia, to various parts of Brazil, South America, then to other parts of the world, and also your intention and your willingness, both are really remarkable. Because you have taken so much time out of your busy schedule to talk about all these things. I would like to talk a little bit about it. How do you think various other research avenues are available apart from this cross-sectional study which you have talked about as a first phase? Any other ways in which you feel that heartfulness meditation can be a part of various other research things which are going across the world?
No, absolutely. I mean, the cross-sectional is an easy one to start with and very fast, because people to get people to commit to certain things sometimes is difficult. But if you just send them the questionnaire, just answer this, and then we're going to look at the results, it's much easier. But in the labs down in Brazil and here in the United States, with the two places I generally work with, like the in the colleges here, It's easy also to conduct interventional studies where we do evaluations, and then we can be more specific. We could use EEG systems, we could use heart variability measurements, we could use a lot of different other tools to do that, do the baseline and then do the intervention and then do the reevaluation. And in the lab in Brazil, we're very, very much specialized in measuring parameters like cytokines, anti-inflammatory cytokines, growth factors, whatever, in the serum and the blood. So we can add that to the research that would bring it to another level, I think. And it's something that the lab, as I said, is now one of the lines of work of the lab because of you. So you're going to be involved for sure.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It will be my pleasure and honor to be with you.
It's mine.
Now I would like to talk a little bit about, like you have already mentioned, that this COVID-19 epidemic, tomorrow there may be something else, then there might be something else. So I know that Brazil and India both are suffering very badly today in this world.
Yes.
And we need to develop many various other technologies as we go ahead. But for everything, we need the fundings. So what is your status? How you can elaborate upon it? What are the avenues of having the funding for doing any of these research? Because every research needs funding. Otherwise, we can't do anything about it.
Yeah, you're right. So there's a lot of, actually there are specific fundings for BRICS, you know, for countries which include Brazil and India. So we're part of BRICS. So that's one way of looking at it. But In Brazil, there is starting to come a lot of different fundings to deal with stress. I know of one specifically. It's interesting that you mentioned that we're just looking at that in Brazil. That's from the government of Brazil, the National Health Institute in the country, and then they're promoting non-invasive technologies that you can use at home, that are easily accessible and that are helping people deal with stress because of COVID, specifically those. I mean, heartfulness meditation is, it fits right there. So, and if we can deliver this through the apps, which you already have, and I know that you already have sessions in, or the translations to Portuguese, that could be very much easily integrated. You know, so so it's something that we have to talk more offline after the interview about, because that's it just came out last week.
Yeah, that's fantastic, because funding, if we can mobilize out, then perhaps we can be we can recruit more number of people to do a multicentric study, which can give some meaningful and viable data that heartfulness meditation not only works at the emotional level, but it also causes, as you have very correctly told, the physical changes are there, and we can take a snapshot of all of them, and we can also document it. So thank you very much, Dr. Sidral. It is a great pleasure and honor, and I would definitely look forward to doing the research with you. And I would also take it forward that you get the complete support from Heartfulness Institute in getting all the initiatives that you wish to do it in future. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure being with you.
Well, thank you. I mean, this was something that literally is changing my life, you know, making me a better person. And I have to thank you for introducing me this to the method, and for Dodgy and the Heartfulness Association, you know, for making this wonderful experience accessible to so many people. Thank you.
Before we leave this session, can you say, Dodgy, something what actually touched, or from the book literature, any the essence of what you got it from that books, which was given to you? Have you read anything which you like to say something?
I think this is something that is very personal. You know, to each person, it touches you differently. For me, I think it's the awareness part. That's why I mentioned it before. You know, understanding you a little bit more, and understanding what makes you tick, and what makes you, what can make you a better person. You know, it's all about, for me, it's the relationships that you have, and if a tool such as heartfulness meditation is helping me, you know, be a better person and be better for my family, for my friends, and for my community, I think this is the biggest thing that you can imagine. And because it's our mission. I mean, we're here for a reason, and the reason is to be a better person and to help the people around you. And this is helping me do that. So I'm eternally grateful.
Wow, fantastic. So thank you very much, Dr. Sidral. It is a pleasure being with you. Thank you.
Thank you.